Okay, thank you for inviting me to this workshop. And in a sense, I will continue the previous talk with a model in which we can implement all the things Marcel discussed before on the top coupling determination. The model that I will propose is a model in, for composite in which the Higgs is a composite particle. And okay, why we want still to go beyond the standard model, because from the moment being, the signal observed by the LHC could not be the fundamental standard model Higgs, so there is still a space for beyond standard model scenarios. And yesterday you had several talks on composite Higgs scenarios, so you know everything on this possibility. These scenarios naturally describe also extra spin 1 and spin 1 half resonances, and they give a rich phenomenology at future colliders. So I will propose a minimal effective calculable description, which is the four-dimensional composite X model, to describe, to study this phenomenology. Just a few words to remind you the basic idea, which dates back to the 80s. The Higgs is a Goldstone boson, just like the pions are Goldstone boson for QCD, and it is related to the breaking of a strong sector to H. And if this symmetry is exact, the Higgs is massless, but it gains its mass due to the fact that you have an explicit breaking of the symmetry due to the weak forces, the standard model forces, and the mass of the Higgs is generated by the radiative correction with an effective potential, which is the Coleman-Weinberg potential. So the Higgs mass depends on the weak coupling and on the scale, the composite scale. How construct a complete composite X model? The basic ingredient that we need are four Goldstone bosons, which are the four variables of the Higgs doublet. And then in order to have a computable Higgs mass, we need a finite one-loop effective potential. The composite resonances must be described in this scheme. And in order to have not too large tuning, you need that this parameter here, which is the ratio of the weak scale and the F scale, which is the scale to which the strong force break to the SO4 in this minimal description, is not too big. So we will choose this scale in the TeV range. With F equal to 1 TeV, the tuning is around 10%. The minimal model was proposed in 2004, and it has a custodial SO2, and it is formulated in five dimensions, describing the breaking of SO5 to SO4, and with the Higgs, as I said, a pseudo-Nambu Goldstone boson of this breaking. How to construct explicit models in four dimensions? The ingredients must be the strong sector with extra resonances, both spin 1 and spin 1 half, with a typical mass at the composite scale, and coupling, which is a strong coupling, the elementary sector describing the standard model fields, and the mixing between these two sectors. You have basically two ways of describing these dynamics. The first one is a general low-energy effective description, which is based mainly on the Kallan-Coleman-Wessel-Zumino formalism. And it is guided by the symmetry properties of the theory. The other approach is via discrete models, which are essentially the construction of the five-dimensional model. and they have the bonus to describe only the composite degrees of freedom which are accessible by the LSE and the calculability. I will follow the second way, and the model that I will use to describe the phenomenology of the composite X scenario is the four-dimensional composite X model. This is the strong sector, the composite sector, the elementary sector, and the sigma model fields which regulate the mixing between these two sectors. F is the Gostung boson decay constant, and the composite spectrum describe spin 1 resonances of SO4 and also the axial vector resonances of the coset group. Concerning the fermion sector, we choose to put the extra fermions in the fundamental representation of SO5, and the minimum number, and we allow the minimum number of fermions which ensure to have an effective potential which is finite. So this scheme is the minimal scheme to calculate also the mass of the Higgs, the vacuum expectation value of the Higgs, and all the ingredients which are the basic ingredients for these schemes. Finally, for simplicity, we allow partial compositeness only for the third generation quarks, so the top is partially composite. Summarizing, we have the strong sector and the extra particle content is done by spin 1 and spin 1 half resonances, which have their mass at the F scale, and the sector with the electroweak gauge bosons and the Higgs with mass at V. The partial compositeness is realized by linear couplings of the composite sector with the elementary one, and the standard model hierarchies are generated by the mixings. For example, the mass of the top is given by, this is the Yukawan, which comes from the mixing of the top with the extra fermions. Having this scheme, the first question that we ask to us is to check if it can describe the Higgs-like particle which was seen at LHC. But in order to do this, it is necessary to implement this model in a tool, because the spectrum is quite large and also the number of parameters. It describes 5 extra-neutral gauge bosons, 3 charged bosons, and 20 extra fermions. So we implement the four-dimensional composite X model in LANEP and CALCAP, and we scan over the model parameters with these inputs and benchmark points which are obtained by varying the scale, the composite scale, and the strong coupling in a natural interval. And about what about the Higgs signal at LHC? For sure, we know that the Higgs coupling to the standard model states are modified in the schemes. And for example, the Higgs total width get a 15 to 20% reduction with respect to the standard model. Also, for production and decay channel, heavy bosonics and fermionic states can play a role via loops, but the Nambu-Gostung boson symmetry protects the couplings. So at the end, we do not have large deviations. We performed a chi-square analysis. Different colors are different benchmark points, and we compare with the experimental measurements of these four decay channels for the Higgs. And what we found is that the 4D composite Higgs model can fit as well as the standard model the data. So at the end, if the LHC will not measure deviations from the standard model larger than 10% and does not discover any new particle, how can we decide if the Higgs is elementary or it is a composite state of a strong dynamics? In that sense, an electron-positron collider with a cleaner environment for precision measurement could help in detecting deviations. So, and they will be an indirect probe of compositeness in pseudo-Nambu Goldstone boson schemes. What people do generally is to use a parametrization of the Higgs couplings by means of an effective Lagrangian. This is a famous figure in which here you have the mass of the composite spin one resonance, which is naturally described in the schemes, and this is Xi. Xi is v square over f square, okay, and it corresponds to a typical parameter for this scenario. Here you can see the reach of LAC in single and double X production, and also the one from ILC by combining these two options of energies. And in this study, you get that a sensitivity you can reach a sensitivity to on the composite scale, which is really remarkable, 30 to 40 TeV. But there's a warning, because this study is done by using an effective description, and what I will show is that the model details often matter. So the message is, this is a model-independent analysis, but sometimes the model ingredients are not in agreement with this analysis. For example, we studied the single composite X boson production via X-Stralung and vector boson fusion at a future collider with different energy options. And what we found is that extra-gauge bosons exchanged both in X-Stralung and in vector boson fusion play a role for the calculation of this cross-section. For example, here I plot the signal strength for two cases of the Higgs decaying in BB bar and WW. This is their correlation. And the blue and the green corresponds to points we have generated for two different values of F and G rho. These stars are the points obtained in the so-called decoupling limit. That is the limit in which you only consider the correction to the couplings. Since this is the expected, these are the expected accuracies which for the 250 and 500 machine, it is clear that this discrepancy is clearly visible, okay? Why we have these differences? These differences are mainly due to the interference of the Z prime, which is changing the Z channel. The same problem and the same warning will come out for top work precision measurements. This figure was already shown by Marcel first. I redone this feature, the axes are in the other direction, and these are, the red points are several beyond standard model modification of the coupling of the top to the Z, the left coupling and the right coupling. Okay, and you see that the precision of LAC will not disentangle among all of them. This is a scan plot for our model, and you see that for G rho in this interval and F in this interval, we get this modification of the couplings. The black points are obtained by cutting for M, the mass of the composite resonance larger than 2 TeV, and the mass for the top part larger than 600 GeV. Even if you take this limit higher, things are not changing so much. So these points are here, okay? These are the deviations which are predicted by our composite X model. What does it mean? It means that if you have these points with big deviation, then maybe also LAC will find this discrepancy. But you can also have points which are inside the region in which only an ILC, a linear collider, can determine. This transparency was already shown by Marcel, and is showing that you can reach this accuracy by combining various observables of a plus and minus collider. The message is that the determination of left and right couplings of the top to the Z is necessary to better than 1% to distinguish among various beyond standard model physics. We have studied the top part production within our model, and the modification of the process arises via three effects. The first one is the modification of this coupling, which is negligible. Then you have the modification of this coupling, which comes from two sources, the mixing between the top and extra fermions, partial compositeness, and the mixing between Z and Z prime, because the Z prime is exchanged in the S channel. But you also have the S channel exchange of the new Z primes. This is commonly neglected, but can be, as I show, very important also for large masses, because it's the interference which is playing a role. The observables that we have analyzed are the total cross-section. Here we are without polarization, without beam polarization, the forward-backward asymmetry, and also two other asymmetries, which are the double and single spin asymmetry, which focus on the elicity structure, and this is just what you are suggesting, of the top decay products. In fact, you can use one the leptons for top semi-electron decays as spin analyzer, even if, as you said, maybe the error for this reconstruction is a little bit higher. What is important is that AL, which is the single spin asymmetry, is sensitive to the relative sign of vector and axial vector couplings of the Z and Z prime to TT bar. So is a unique possibility to also disentangle interference effects. This is a first result on how much the Z prime exchange in the S channel matter for this physics. Here you have a cross section normalized to the standard model one and forward backward asymmetry with and without the Z prime exchange. This is the complete model, and you can see the deviation, which is up to 10%. But what is strange is that without the Z prime, so including only the coupling modification, you have a deviation, but on the other side. That means that the interference plays a role in moving the deviation on the other part of the cross-section. This is much more visible for a 1 TB, the 2R for 360, and this is for 500. Also in 360, you have sizable deviation. We made the same exercise for a 1 TV machine. Here, the deviation cross sections are really big. You can have up to 40% deviation, but these are mainly due to the interference. This is without the Z prime. And just to show this is the nature of the deviations, we plot here the cross section as a function of the width of one of the two main Z prime which are exchanged in the S channel. And here you find the typical 1/γ shape, which is related to the interference. The different colors are for different masses of the Z prime, which is exchanged. And you can see that also for higher mass, you have really a big deviation. If you want to plot the sensitivity, okay, of the three different options on energies from the cross section in the same plane psi and m rho. This is the result. I have two transparencies more. This is the result, and you see that this is the deviation. For a 500 GV, I get the same result that Marcel showed you, but I'm plotting the maximal deviation. That means that a point which is here, which is a delta larger than 6%, with the same FNG, can correspond another situation in which the width is so large that you cannot have this sensitivity. So this is a warning. Just to finish, I show also this observable, which is very, very important, which is the single spin asymmetry, which is related to the elasticity angle distribution. And you can reconstruct it by looking at the lepton of the semi-electronic decay of the top. And this is are the deviations for 500, and this for 1 TV machine. Since we have 2Z prime in this model, which are exchanged in the S channel, here you start to see the two different contributions of the 2Z prime. In fact, this is AL, they interfere, sorry, it's not clear in this slide, they interfere in opposite sense, with opposite sign. So with the AL, you can, since it is proportional to the coupling, to the first, not to the square of the coupling, but to the coupling, the sign matter in this observable. So this observable here can offer the chance to separate Z2 and Z3 in cases of models in which you have multiple Z prime in the S channel. Just to show, if you have the chance to have polarized electron beam, this will be clear in a much more, here is shown in much more clear manner, because these are the result for fully polarized beam in one sense and the other, and you can really select the two resonances because they interfere in a different way. So the conclusion is that the future E plus E minus machine will have a great potential in testing indirectly the salient features of composite models. If nothing is seen, or better, if the LSE will give some evidence, the E plus E minus machine will give the opportunity to test composite scenarios, both with precise measurement of Higgs and top couplings. But I will conclude with this warning: the interference effects of the new resonances could be crucial and must be taken into account to extract sensitivities. Thank you, and sorry if I'm late.
Questions? I have one. It was not very clear to me when I had that plot where it was a clear deviation with the when you took into account or not the Z prime.
Z prime, yes.
Well, yeah, like, this sort of plot there. The asymmetry, if I look on the projection where you have the spread for the forward backward asymmetry, it seems wider when you don't have the Z prime. So how do they change?
Not very much, the asymmetry.
So the asymmetry is not affected, but in the two cases, you have still the couplings which are varied in the vertex, in the
sure,
TT bar
sure,
Z vertex. It's only the asymmetry interference which is not taken into account.
The points are here. When I say no Z prime, I just take out the Z prime exchange from the calculation of the
it's only that, but the rest of
all the rest is there. So it is with or without the interference.
The interference is only the effect of
exactly,
the interference.
Exactly.
Okay. Any more question or comment? Otherwise, we thank Stefania again.